Thank you for downloading this Council on Foreign Relations video. CFR is an independent national membership organization and nonpartisan research center. For more information, please visit us online at cfr.org.
Good afternoon. My name is Reed Kramer. I'm from All Africa, which many of you know as allafrica.com. And it's my pleasure to welcome you to this session. First, the housekeeping, please turn off, not just put on vibrate, all your cellular and BlackBerry devices, iPhones, etc., because they interfere with the sound system. And also, to remind you, this session is on the record. Before we begin with today's program, the Council is pleased to announce an upcoming reception on Thursday, October 6th, to celebrate the release of The Struggle for Egypt from Nasser to Tahrir Square by CFR Senior Fellow Stephen Cook. For more information, please refer to the insert in the back of today's program. Today we're exploring the implications of famine in East Africa. We're taking a regional focus, although we expect to touch on specifics of several of the countries in that area. And we're pleased to have with us two expert panelists, as is the custom here at the Council. They both have extensive familiarity and experience in East Africa. Jindai Fraser, many of you know, is adjunct senior fellow for African Studies at the Council. She's distinguished public service professor at Carnegie Mellon. She serves in a number of senior U.S. government positions, including Assistant Secretary of State for Africa, and all the other details are in your printed bio. E.J. Hogendorm is the Horn of Africa Project Director for the International Crisis Group. He has worked for the UN panel of experts on Somalia and on Sudan, and as a researcher at Human Rights Watch, and both of them have distinguished PhDs. So I want to begin asking EJ if you could bring us up to date a little bit on what the news that we're getting today out of Mogadishu, that a lot of people, we don't know the exact number, 60, 70 people have been killed by a truck bomb, and what may be, and I want, this is part of the question, a possible resurgence of Al-Shabaab. This is something like the fourth reported attack in a week, but this is clearly in a class of its own. What does this, what happened in brief, and what does this represent in terms of the implications for the topic we're addressing?
Mm-hmm. As far as we know, a truck bomb went off outside a compound of TFG Ministries, the Transitional Federal Government Ministries. Principally targeting the Ministry of Education, and many of the people who were killed were actually students who'd queued up to find out what their exam scores were for scholarships to Turkey that Turkey had just donated a couple of weeks ago to the TFG. Unfortunately, this was not a surprise to many analysts. I think that this was to be expected, given that Al-Shabaab had withdrawn from most of Mogadishu, but still very much wanted to remain relevant and still very much wanted to attack soft targets of the TFG. This was just something that was bound to happen, and it demonstrates the real challenges that the TFG and AMISOM face in terms of securing the capital, let alone the entire country.
And in terms of the famine in specifically in Somalia, relate that to the activities of Al-Shabaab for us, please.
Well, our simplistic view of it, and I hate to be simplistic, but is that if you look at the Greater Horn of Africa, we've had drought in the entire region, but not surprisingly, we only have famine in South and Central Somalia. And we would argue that shows that the famine is not caused necessarily by the drought, but that it's actually the conflict and the fact that there's been low-level insurgency in that region for more than 20 years is the direct cause for the starvation in South and Central Somalia. And unfortunately, in our view, while humanitarian assistance is necessary, if we want to look at a durable solution to famine in the Horn of Africa, we need to look at how can we reestablish peace and stability in the region, especially in Somalia.
So, Dindai, on the regional question, both specifically the regional role for doing what EJ just outlined in terms of security in Somalia, but more broadly, where do you see the key efforts underway and what needs to be happening in that area for region-wide?
Well, I agree with EJ that the core to stopping famine, which is essentially man-made, is to establish peace and stability in the Horn of Africa generally, but absolutely, and particularly in Somalia. It's not going to be easy. I think part of the challenge, particularly for U.S. policy, is the way in which we distribute our foreign assistance dollars. First and foremost, they go to humanitarian disaster, humanitarian relief. There's significant amounts of resources for that, but there's not significant amount of resources for peace and stability or stabilization operations, nor for the work that needs to ultimately be done on governance. And so I think that that's part of the challenge. Luckily, in the region, there is almost unanimity among the neighboring states, that being the IGAD, the Intergovernmental Authority on Drought or Development now, I guess it's called, Intergovernmental Authority on Development, the IGAD countries being Ethiopia, Kenya, Djibouti, Sudan is in there. They you know, have a, you know, and I'm leaving out Eritrea, which was kicked out of IGAD, they do have the same view about Somalia, and that view is basically that you need to increase security through a peacekeeping operation, and AMISOM, the AU mission, is that peacekeeping operation, but they have consistently called for a UN peacekeeping operation, so more support on the UN side for peace and stability. I happen to think that they're right. I know that that is a very controversial position, particularly since our own experience working with the UN in the early 90s have led us to sort of abandon the thought of quote-unquote boots on the ground, Western boots on the ground in Somalia. But I think that I would associate myself with the AU call for a UN peacekeeping operation. And then there's obviously the governance challenge, and that being the transitional federal government essentially being inept, and having been so since it was, since its birth. No matter who the president is or the prime minister, it seems that, in fact, that transitional federal government has been incapable of reconciling the various Somali political factions. And then there's fourth, I guess, or maybe fifth, is obviously the counterterrorism. Al-Shabaab and its elements, particularly as associated with the East Africa Al-Qaeda cell, but now that Al-Qaeda generally does not want governance in Somalia. They want to continue a situation of chaos and a situation of a failed state. They can operate better under those circumstances. And so I think the notion that somehow you can reconcile with Al-Shabaab is somewhat naive. And it's going to take consolidating governance and stability with those parties that are interested in that, and fully confronting Al-Shabaab, probably militarily.
You mentioned the proposed UN role, which has been resisted, including by the United States. Even broader than peacekeeping is the question of the UN involvement in Somalia, which has historically, for many years now, been almost entirely Kenya-based. The former Special Envoy, UN Special Envoy, Special Representative for Somalia, had a number, told me in an interview, I think he had a number of 5,000 people working in Nairobi or environs on Somalia, and he was advocating, let's take them to Mogadishu and what a difference that would make. Do you think that's something that should be done, and do you think it would work?
I certainly think they should be taken to Somalia. Mogadishu certainly the target area,
right.
And as Assistant Secretary, obviously, I also push for the U.S., you know, so it's hard to point fingers at the U.N. when the U.S. is even more absent from Somalia than many other international